ocean, no valley, no mountain too high. No power on earth, there's no distance too wide. No height or no depth could keep me from your love. No failure, no weakness, no doubt in my mind. No prison around me could keep you outside. No, not even death could pull me from your arms. Nothing ever could separate us. Nothing ever could separate us. Nothing ever could separate us. Now. And when I can't see you, still I know you're here. And when I can't feel you, your promise is clear. Nothing I face can keep me from your love. My savior, my healer, my life and my hope. My treasure forever, with you I belong. And even in death, you won't be torn.
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity United Church of Christ here in Waynesboro, an open and affirming congregation that truly tries to put into practice the statement that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. It's a joy to have you joining us via Facebook Live, and I just have a few announcements to share with you before we move into our worship service. First of all, we are, again, in need of food items for our blessing box. And if you cannot bring in food items, we would love to have any kind of financial assistance. The blessing box has really been used, especially during this COVID time. It just seems that people are constantly in need of food. So it has been a true blessing for our neighborhood here. But we really need your help in order to keep the box full of food. Want to let you know that Lent is just on the horizon. Please know that we are going to be offering two Lenten studies this year, both beginning on February 25th, Thursday at noon, and Thursday night at 7. The study at noon will be entitled Forgiveness, a Lenten Study by Marjorie Thompson. And the Zoom gathering in the evening will be a study on prayer. The title of it is Dangerous Prayers. Prayer can sometimes be a very dangerous activity. Many times, prayer does not necessarily change the mind of God, but it changes us. It changes our hearts, and that can be a very dangerous thing. We'll be looking at the prayers of many different people, such as some great theologians like Martin Luther and Dietrich Bonhoeffer, John Calvin, Reinhold Niebuhr, and Henry Nouwen. We'll be looking at the prayers of civil rights leaders, such as Harriet Beecher Stowe and Sojourner Truth, Rosa Parks, Harriet Tubman and Martin Luther King Jr., as well as prayers of historical figures such as Johann Sebastian Bach and Corrie ten Boom and Helen Keller, Abraham Lincoln, St. Patrick, and George Washington. So both of those are two opportunities for you to join via Zoom, actually see some people in person and interact with people. We all need that interaction in these times. Don't forget, this Thursday night is the last of our series that the Fellowship of Churches, Waynesboro Fellowship of Churches, is offering, our Zoom webinar series. That's this Thursday, the 11th at 6:30. I believe those are our announcements that we have for this morning. Let us prepare our hearts now for our worship through our organ prelude. Let us join together in our responsive call to worship. Worship God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. The God of creation does not faint or grow weary.
How good it is to sing praises to our God. How expansive is God's understanding of us.
The whole universe is subject to God's power. Creation continues as the universe expands.
God rules all time and space, yet cares about us. God is pleased with all who reflect steadfast love.
Sing to God with great thanksgiving. Praise God with the best you have to offer.
We lift up our eyes to see God's wonders. We open our ears to receive God's message.
Join our hearts and our minds together in prayer. Powerful God, before whom we are as nothing, we dare to approach you because you assure us that we are not like mere grasshoppers to you. Our individual potential is not hidden from you, and the faithfulness of your church is important to you. We have gathered with great expectation, seeking to have our strength renewed and our hope restored. Make yourself known among us as we unite in your praise. Amen. I encourage you to come away from your pretensions to examine your relationship with God. Break away from your illusions of independence to realize your responsibility in the church. Claim your unity in Christ with all God's children, then realize how much you need to confess your brokenness and to seek the healing touch of God. Let us come to God in prayer through our prayer of confession. Who are we to claim equality with you, ruler of all worlds? Yet we try to order you around when it is we who should be taking orders. At times, we act as if we can get along without you. In our church, we often pretend that we don't need other congregations. We hoard the gospel as if it were our possession, and thus we do not follow its mandates. We bend your law to our own whims, and then excuse our disobedience. Forgive us, God. We are not worthy to carry the name of Christ. Restore us to yourself, we pray. Amen. God calls each of us by name. Every community of faith is known to God, whose understanding is unlimited. The one who knows our hearts is eager to forgive the truly penitent and to empower those who have grown weary. Your strength is being renewed in these moments. You will mount up with wings like eagles. You will run and not be weary. You will walk and not faint. Praise God for the forgiveness we receive through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Can you hear me, Mr. Holland? Okay. There's always a problem with me and not being heard. Welcome this morning to this another snowy day. If you know how to make snow cream, which I showed you how to make in my message for this week, if you scrape it off the top, this is great snow to do that. So do that today. But today, we're going to talk about Jesus again. And Jesus, if we look, showed his love by all the actions. So I want you to think about how you care and show you care about someone else. And while you're thinking, I have something I need to take care of first. So you think, what do you do to show that you care about someone? Give me about 20 seconds. Sorry about you guys upstairs. It takes too long. Okay. So what I did is I shared my kindness with people that I know and I love, but they weren't expecting it. So did you think of some things and ways that you do that? Okay. Well, I have some you may not have thought about. Just listening to what someone has to say without talking, without judging. Say thank you when someone does something nice for you without being told to do it. Forgive them when they hurt you. Write them a kind note. Give them a gift for no reason. Offer encouragement when they're discouraged. Volunteer to help when there's a difficult time going on. Share a snack with them. Those are all ones we may not think about sometimes because they're done without anybody knowing about it or asking for it. Now, on the piano, I have some things that I know we do. We might send a card to say, I'm thinking about you. This is for my grandson, Julian, who loves trucks. So I'm going to give him a book. He's not asking for that book, but he will love it just the same and know I care about him. A thank you card, maybe taking a gift of a plant to someone, or there's a sad time, so you send a sympathy card. Those are all things that we do normally. The things that I read were things we may not think about sometimes. So even if you just give someone a friendly hello or a smile, you don't know how that could make that person feel. When I put food in the blessing box, I feel like I'm sharing kindness to people I don't even know. And I hope they know that we care about them because we provide that for them. Now, Jesus was always kind, too. And I got to thinking, seems like I have one theme. It's all about being kindness and showing compassion. But if we look at Jesus' life, that's what his life was about. That's what he taught us. So, Jesus traveled all over Galilee and teaching, meeting with people, sharing kindness with them all the time. And those were long days for him, teaching and showing kindness and compassion, to the point where, you know, he probably got tired with it sometimes, okay, and thought, how can I do this anymore? So I have my cell phone. Okay, a lot of us have cell phones. What do we do when the battery runs down? We have to recharge it so it can work some more. Well, that's what Jesus knew as well. Even though he might have been tired of walking around and preaching and teaching and showing kindness and compassion, and he got really tired, he figured out he needed to recharge his battery. So what Jesus would do was find a really quiet place to pray. And that way he recharged his spiritual battery so that he could continue to show kindness and teach. Now, people, we all need to recharge our batteries, just like my phone. We work really hard, we play hard. If we don't get enough rest, pretty soon we just don't have enough energy to do anything. And that's how it might feel when we're always showing kindness and smiling at people and saying hello and offering to help. So if Jesus thought for him it was important to recharge his spiritual battery, don't you think it's important for us as well? So when you feel that your battery is low and you just can't be you can't be kind anymore, do what Jesus did. Find a quiet place. Pray. Take a nap. Take a walk. Bake. Sew. Do whatever works for you to recharge your battery so you can get back out there and share your kindness and compassion, just as Jesus did. So remember to show others you care by doing acts of kindness each and every day, just like Jesus. And when your battery is running low, stop and recharge your spirit, just like Jesus did. So think about, how is your spiritual battery feeling today? Let's say a prayer. Jesus, you taught us how to care for one another. Help us to follow your example and show our love by acts of kindness towards others. And to remember that just as our bodies, our spirit must be recharged from time to time. Amen. Have another great snowy day. I'll have a message on Wednesday. It'll probably be the same message because I'm not going to try to come up with something else. So I'll talk to you next week. Bye-bye.
Good morning, everybody. Our first scripture lesson today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 16 to 23. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. That was from Paul, of course. Our gospel lesson today is from Mark, the first chapter, verses 29 to 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now, Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. He was recharging his spiritual battery. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. Here ends the reading of the word today. May you hold it in your hearts and reflect on it often.
Let us pray. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of our hearts be upon you, you who are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Could it be that Jesus was getting a little stressed out in our gospel reading for today? As Karen already mentioned, he really needed to recharge his spiritual batteries. Consider the fact that Jesus is teaching in the synagogue, he's healing Peter's mother-in-law, he's healing the sick, he's casting out demons, he's pushing through the crowds are gathering around the house, there's more healing, more casting out, crowds, the city demands noise. So the next morning, while it was still dark, Jesus slips out of the city to find some solitude in a deserted place. It was what he needed to do, and it's what thousands of people do sometimes on a Sunday morning when they go out with a bag of clubs and play a round of golf. When Jesus went to a deserted place, he prayed. That's not what most golfers do when they set up on the first tee, unless it's a prayer concerning their slice. And there's no way the experience of golf can be equated with a deeply spiritual, mystical experience. But there are some lessons for our spiritual lives to be learned from both Jesus' flight to a quiet place and a golfer's drive to the green. These are lessons which have already been noted by a number of people, one of whom was Lee Trevino, a very popular golfer. He may be known more for his swing than his spirituality, but he grasped something significant that Christians everywhere ought to consider. Lee Trevino said, "There are two things that you can do with your head down: play golf and pray." Let the golfers among us say, "Amen."
Amen.
Certainly, the faithful on the fairways would like their putting to count as prayer, but before we scoff at their spiritualized slicing and chuckle at their Christianized chip shots, consider this radical proposal. Golf can be spiritually therapeutic And as a game offers some significant insights into how God wants us to live. The hackers hitting the links, maybe not today, but on any other day when the course isn't covered with this white stuff, they could be doing the very same thing. Millions of Americans suit up for golf, sometimes even on a Sunday morning, while millions more are suiting up for church. And apparently they find 3 hours on the links to be more satisfying and intriguing than 1 hour in the pew. Now, being an avid golfer and a minister, I'm really not sure how to respond to that statement. Perhaps this weekly ritual is its own kind of sanctuary, this golf sanctuary. Golfers may be savoring a form of spiritual growth that people sitting in the pews struggle to attain in the course of a standard Sunday morning worship service. You may ask, is this some kind of joke? Is this some kind of setup for a sarcastic slam against golf course spirituality? Not at all. Golf can teach us a great deal about life. In fact, psychiatrist M. Scott Peck, in his book Golf and the Spirit, Lessons for the Journey, argues that golf is life condensed. It's a game that contains many spiritual and emotional challenges in a small amount of time and space. People persistently line up to shell out big bucks for this game that we call golf because, quite frankly, it's good for their souls. Might not be great for their wallets or even their moods, but it is good for their souls. In his book, Scott Peck asserts that golf, next to marriage and parenthood, can be the greatest of life's learning opportunities. As a psychiatrist and a Christian, he knows firsthand that we are willing creatures living in a world that doesn't often behave the way we want it to, very much like our golf swings. But he also senses that how we deal with the hazards of life is quite similar to how we deal with the hazards on a golf course. For example, golf is the finest possible training ground for humility. No, I take that back. It's the best training ground for humiliation. If you've ever picked up a golf club, you know that this is the truth with a capital T. It's not for nothing that golf is called the weekly humiliation. Golf is a game that pushes players to attain perfection in driving, pitching, and putting. And it never happens that all three of those are good on any given day of golf. But that is a goal that's clearly unattainable for human beings. Even the greatest golfers in the world hit some ugly, awful, embarrassing, and just plain bad shots once in a while. And the hole that lures every golfer across hundreds of yards of grass is properly named, insists Scott Peck. He says it's called a hole because it can suggest the pits of hell. While I enjoy being humiliated, he confesses, I do need it. It's a part of spiritual growth. Scott Peck links this daily dying experience to the Christian discipline of kenosis, which means self-emptying. In kenosis, we are challenged to get out of our own way and empty ourselves of anger, self-centeredness, and false hopes. To be specific, Scott Peck preaches and shares these points. He says, be attentive to the hazards ahead of you, but empty yourself of your fear of them. He also says, strive to do your best, but empty yourself of your concern with your score. or learn from every mistake, but empty yourself of any shred of self-hatred for your imperfections. Compete, but empty yourself of shame that you're not measuring up. He says, play to win, but if you fail to do so, empty yourself of remorse. And he says, use your mulligan. And for those of you not familiar with that term, a mulligan is sort of like a forgiveness shot. When you hit a shot that's absolutely horrible, you can take another shot to replace the horrible one. As a little side note, it's even more humiliating when the mulligan is just as bad as the first shot, if not worse. But also he says, don't be afraid to take an unplayable lie. Or, this is the big one, play one hole at a time. These are all tantalizing tips for the game of life as well as for the game of golf. We are healthiest in spirit when we are humble as Jesus, the one who emptied himself for the sake of all humankind. Golf also convinces us of the inescapable necessity of teachers. Whether we admit it or not, we all need help with our game, and we should welcome the friends, the mentors, and the teaching pros that God sends us when we need them. Mentoring is an essentially fruitful form of guidance because it carries with it a form of unconditional love and concern for the individual. When a mentor reaches out to us, the one desire is to make us better. Getting away to that deserted place can keep our lives in balance and bring us closer to God. In such a place, whether it's on a golf course or at the lake or in the backyard, we can be reminded to live in the tension of life, the tension between our yearning for perfection on the one hand and our tendency toward imperfection on the other. But golf especially can help us to empty ourselves, remembering that the point of self-emptying is not to diminish ourselves, but to make room within ourselves for something new and unexpected and life-enhancing and divine. Scott Peck admits that he used to be enraged at himself for failing to be perfect on the links and really every day of life. But then one day he had an experience on the golf course that opened his mind to new possibilities. He recalls that he was paired as a twosome with a man about his own age. This man was a top-ranking executive of a golf products corporation, and benefiting from his profession, he was a superb golfer with a single-digit handicap. He was also a gentleman, literally as well as metaphorically. He was a gentle person, and therefore one I was unusually open to learn from. He taught me several worthwhile things about golf that day, but the most valuable thing was on the 15th hole when he noticed that I was depressed after a triple bogey on the 14th hole, and as a result, continued to play poorly. You know, he commented mildly, we have an expression in golf, one hole at a time. A light bulb, says Scott Peck, went off in his head. Of course. Just like the famed Alcoholics Anonymous slogan, one day at a time, it had to be true that the way to approach golf was one hole at a time. In other words, don't become obsessed with the past. Don't become paralyzed by concerns about perfection or imperfection. Forgive yourself. Unburden yourself. Love your imperfect self in the same way that God loves your imperfect self. Play the game of life one hole at a time. If we do this, we'll discover that golf and life together are a spiritual journey, an adventure that involves emotional turmoil, deep learning, inner change, and the emptying of old patterns so that new ones can be added. Golf breaks us down like a prayer of confession, and then builds us up like an assurance of pardon or an assurance of forgiveness. Well-hit shots can send our spirits soaring like a song of praise, and a successfully tapped-in putt can give us a deep satisfaction of a silent prayer. A difficult lie can challenge us like a provocative sermon, and the compliment of a golfing partner can cheer us like the passing of the peace. Most of all, the game reveals our weaknesses along with our strengths and reminds us of our rightful place in the world that our Lord has created. Golf is like God, suggests Scott Peck. It's bigger than you. Now, if this message inspires you to consider playing golf, wonderful. We'll be starting our golf league up again sometime in April or May, depending on when the weather breaks. The game can be a soul-searching spiritual discipline, bringing you sometimes closer to heaven and sometimes to your knees. But when golf is doing the job God wants it to, it shouldn't consume your every Sunday morning. Instead, it should train you to keep your head down for praying as well as playing, and lead you back to church for the public worship of God. Amen.
Sing, sing.
Thank you, ladies. Beautiful job. We come to the portion of our worship experience where we lift each other up in our burdens, in our needs, and in our times when we need to support one another. Our prayer list comes out every Tuesday, and I just hope and pray that you continue to look at all the names that are on that prayer list. I want to re-add Tammy Kaufman to the prayer list. She's recovering from some surgery, it's going to be a little bit of time before she can recover completely. So keep Tammy Kaufman in your prayers. I want to add another thought to our prayers. We need to keep each other in our prayers, because one of the things that has come out in these webinars that we have been offering to the community via the Waynesboro Area Fellowship of Churches, we've had three excellent speakers so far on Thursday nights. John Dorhauer, our UCC General Minister and President, and Reverend Dr. Lois Waters, who's a pastor over in Chambersburg, and Reverend Tabitha Sanko, who's a pastor at Monumental AME Church in Steelton. All three of these speakers have been wonderful, but they have been calling us to the point of saying that it's up to us. Reconciliation is not something that just happens. It requires hard work. And I know that I was watching the NFL National Football League Awards show last night, and Russell Wilson, who's the quarterback for Seattle, he received the Walter Payton Man of the Year Award. And he started a foundation which is entitled Why Not You, is the name of the foundation. And he had a wonderful acceptance speech last night where he talked about how sometimes we are called as individuals to do things that we sometimes feel we're not able to do or capable of doing, but we are called to be the catalyst, to be the starting point for change to really happen within the society that we live in and the world around us. So please keep each other in your prayers as we work toward trying to reconcile our differences, as we try to heal the racial divides that exist within our country today. Keep in mind that it's not an easy task, but it's something that we need to truly work on and move forward on. Let's join our hearts and our minds together in prayer. O Holy One, we come to you in need of your leading and your instruction this morning. We are so often bogged down in the details of life and forget to see the bigger picture of life and its needs. We so often give ourselves to what we think is necessary and fail to see what is needed. Forgive us our short-sightedness and save us from our spiritual narrow-mindedness. We have been reminded today of how Jesus met needs all about him, but didn't surrender to the tyranny of demands and the many insisting voices. Help us to follow his example. Whereas we tend to think in terms of doing things primarily where we live, he thought of people everywhere who had needs. Whereas we tend to take our signals from others, he took his direction from within. Whereas we tend to live life at a frantic pace, he went out to the desert alone and prayed to find renewal. Whereas we tend to think small and local in the scope of our concerns, he thought of other communities who needed the good news. As we walk the Christian journey, we pray that you will provide us a greater vision. Interrupt our frenzied activity. Help us to find the creative spiritual pause which will make clearer our mission and refresh us for carrying it out. Help us to see all people as your people and to know that we have the responsibility to love them. Help us to have the courage to change the way we have gone about life and to make it both more rewarding and more fruitful. We ask your care for all the suffering of the world. Be with those who are living with the effects of natural disasters, Be with those who are living with the effects of war. Be with those who are hungry, those who are homeless. Be with those who are living through this COVID age. Provide all your people with comfort. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We come to the portion of our worship service where we traditionally receive our tithes and offerings. We have an obligation to proclaim the gospel to the world. We are entrusted with a commission. So we give freely of our time and abilities where we are, and we send and support the witness of others where we cannot go. I'd like to encourage you to continue to give generously in these times of COVID. Please consider sending in your tithes and offerings. And yes, go ahead.
Yes, continue our tithes and offering. And I just wanted to say thank you very much to all those who contributed to the soup sales. We mailed over $600, and I just wasn't sure if Pastor Bruce was going to say that.
It was in my notes, okay, but I didn't pay attention to it. So thank you for reminding me.
Thank all the members who contributed to that.
Thank you. Yes, in case you didn't hear, Deb, we made over $600 with our soup sales. Thank you to everybody who made soup, but also thank you to everybody who purchased a quart of soup. And that, as Deb said, will be going toward our mission trip. If we are able to take our mission trip in July, we're still not sure about that. But yes, thank you. Thank you for the reminder as well. I wrote it down and I forgot to say it. Okay, very good. Let us join together in our prayer of dedication for all these good gifts. Thank you, God, for showing us a better way to live than we are able to devise for ourselves. Thank you for reaching out to win our hearts. Thank you for Jesus Christ, for the ministry that extended your love to the least and the lost, for the powerful presence that offered wholeness to those who were sick or brokenhearted, for the prayers that demonstrated how we too can be in communion with you. In gratitude, we dedicate this offering. Amen.
Amen.
to serve. Someone needs you today. What you have to give will be helpful to someone.
We pray God will open our eyes to needs around us. We will look for ways to be helpful.
Go in the name of Jesus Christ, who sends us. Speak a healing word. Do a caring deed.
God binds up wounds of the brokenhearted. Surely God will empower our ministry.
God strengthens the powerless and helps the weak. God's power will be in you when you pray.
We shall run and not be weary. We will serve in the strength God supplies.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Thanks be to God. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Mountain rises higher, the way seems so unclear.